sisters and brothers of America. It fills my heart with joy unspeakable to rise in response to the warm and cordial welcome which you have given us. I thank you in the name of the most ancient order of monks in the world. I thank you in the name of the mother of religions. And I thank you in the name of the millions and millions of Hindu people of all classes and sects. My thanks also to some of the speakers on this platform who, referring to the delegates from the Orient, have told you that these men from far-off nations may well claim the honor of bearing to different lands the idea of toleration. I am proud to belong to a religion which has taught the world both tolerance and universal acceptance. We believe not only in universal toleration, but we accept all religions as true. I am proud to belong to a nation which has sheltered the persecuted and the refugees of all religions and all nations of the earth. I am proud to tell you that we have gathered in our bosom the purest remnant of the Israelites who came to southern India and took refuge with us in the very year in which their holy temple was shattered to pieces by Roman tyranny. I am proud to belong to the religion which has sheltered and is still fostering the remnant of the grand Zoroastrian nation. I bequeath to you, brethren, a few lines from a hymn which I remember to have repeated from my earliest poem, which is every day repeated by millions of human beings. As the different streams, having their sources in different places, all mingle their water in the sea, so, O Lord, the different paths which men take through different tendencies, various though they appear, crooked or straight, all lead to Thee. The present convention, which is one of the most august assemblies ever held, is in itself a vindication, a declaration to the world of the wonderful doctrine preached in the Gita. Whosoever comes to me, through whatsoever form, I reach him. All men are struggling through paths which in the end lead to me. Sectarianism, bigotry, and its horrible descendant, fanaticism, have long possessed this beautiful earth. They have filled the earth with violence, drenched it often and often with human blood, destroyed civilization, and sent whole nations to despair. If not been for these horrible demons, human society would be far more advanced than it is now. But their time is come, and I fervently hope that the bell that tolls this morning in honor of this convention may be the death knell of all fanatics, of all persecutions with the sword or with the pen, and of all uncharitable feelings between persons wending their way to the same goal.
Ladies and gentlemen, on the agenda for today, the 15th of September, 1893, a galaxy of eminent speakers are scheduled to address us, and it gives us great pleasure to once again invite Swami Vivekananda to speak. His subject for today, Why We Disagree.
I will tell you a little story. You have heard the eloquent speaker who has just finished say, let us cease from abusing each other, and he was very sorry that there should be always so much variance. But I think I should tell you a story which would illustrate the cause of this variance. A frog lived in a well. It had lived there for a long time. It was born there. A little sleek and fat. Well, one day, another frog that lived in the sea came and fell into the well. Where are you from? I am from the sea. The sea? How big is that?
Is it as big as my well? And he took a leap from one side of the well to the other. My friend, said the frog of the sea, how do you compare the sea with your little well? Then the frog took another leap and asked, is your sea so big? What nonsense you speak to compare the sea with your well. Well then, said the frog of the well, nothing can be bigger than my well. There can be nothing bigger than this. This fellow is a liar, so turn him out. That has been the difficulty all the while. I am a Hindu. I'm sitting in my own little well and thinking that the whole world is my little well. The Christian sits in his little well and thinks the whole world is his well. The Mohammedan sits in his little well and thinks that is the whole world. I have to thank you of America for the great attempt you're making to break down the barriers of this little world of ours, and hope that in the future, the Lord will help you to accomplish your purpose.
Delegates and friends, today, the 19th of September, 1893, is the ninth day of the World's Parliament of Religions. We have had the privilege of listening to many distinguished speakers from the world over address us on a variety of subjects. The time is at hand to now listen to the great monk from India, Swami Vivekananda, read his paper on Hinduism. Ladies and gentlemen, Swami Vivekananda.
From the high spiritual flights of the Vedanta philosophy, of which the latest discoveries of science seem like echoes, to the low ideas of idolatry with its multifarious mythology, the agnosticism of the Buddhists and the atheism of the Jains, each and all have a place in the Hindu's religion. Where then, the question arises, where is the common center to which all these widely diverging radii converge? Where is the common basis upon which all these seemingly hopeless contradictions rest? And this is the question I shall attempt to answer. The Hindus have received their religion through revelation, the Vedas. They hold that the Vedas are without beginning and without end. It may sound ludicrous to this audience how a book can be without beginning or end. But by the Vedas, no books are meant. They mean the accumulated treasury of spiritual laws discovered by different persons in different times. Just as the law of gravitation existed before its discovery and would exist if all humanity forgot it, so is it with the laws that govern the spiritual world. The moral, ethical, and spiritual relations between soul and soul and between individual spirits and the Father of all spirits were there before their discovery and would remain even if we forgot them. The discoverers of these laws are called rishis, and we honor them as perfected beings. I'm glad to tell this audience that some of the very greatest of them were women. Here it may be said that these laws, as laws, may be without end, but they must have had a beginning. The Vedas teach us that creation is without beginning or end. Science is said to have proved that the sum total of cosmic energy is always the same. Then, if there was a time when nothing existed, where was all this manifested energy? Some say it was in a potential form in God. In that case, God is sometimes potential and sometimes kinetic, which would make him mutable. Everything mutable is a compound, and everything compound must undergo that change which is called destruction. So, God would die, which is absurd. Therefore, there never was a time when there was no creation. If I may be allowed to use a simile, creation and creator are two lines without beginning and without end, running parallel to each other. God is the ever-active providence by whose power systems after systems are being evolved out of chaos, made to run for a time and again destroyed. This is what the Brahmin boy repeats every day.